So welcome
to
Göteborg and to TV Drama Vision. But this is not your first visit in the city, right?
No.
No. No. Tell us, it's quite an interesting reason why you've been here before.
I had come here previously because my daughter is a fencer. And there's a World Cup fencing tournament here. And so I was familiar with the city only through fencing, through getting up in the morning with a big bag of blades and walking through the snow and making it to a venue. So I'm very happy to be here and to be able to have breakfast and meet people. And so this is great.
Okay, perfect. And you're staying both of the days, so you'll have time to meet a lot of people. I also hear that you are a huge fan of Nordic drama.
I am.
So tell us a little bit, what series do you like?
I really enjoyed, of course, Scam. And Modus, I enjoyed very much.
Actually, I have personal greetings from the producer of Modus.
Oh.
Because I was talking to her, she was coming, and then she had to cancel, and she said that she really wanted you to know that she appreciates
My pleasure. It was really wonderful to watch the show. And of course, you know, the classics, you know, The Bridge and amongst others. I mean, I just think that the Nordic dramas. I was speaking with Lars this morning about
the producer of Bron, who's also the head of the jury. We'll
meet
him later.
About how sometimes the constraints of working in an area where you have perhaps more limited budget actually creates better drama, because you're forced to look at sort of character and situation in a way that is where your stories and your characters need to be compelling unto themselves, and you can't hide behind sort of larger productions or special effects and things like that. And I think that the Nordic region has really done a brilliant job, both literarily and in translating their stories to television and film. Yeah. So I'm a fan.
Great. We always want to start with this kind of, someone from abroad knows about us. It's a thing we have that was more prevalent several years ago, because now, of course, we know that we are an interesting region. So we're going to talk about your time at HBO, when you started up the drama department, you started up the miniseries department, and we're going to talk about your last decade of producing really big, lavish historical dramas like Rome and Versailles and Britannia, that we're going to see a trailer or we're going to watch a lot of clips. But I wanted to start from the beginning. And your father, Tony Tomopoulos, he was the president of ABC Broadcast.
Yes.
So you kind of, and this was at the time when there were only three networks.
Yeah, it was a very,
it sounds ancient.
It was a very, very different time. I mean, there were three networks. Obviously, there was no video on demand. There was no home video. There was nothing. So, you know, I remember his ratings for shows like, you know, Roots or Charlie's Angels when I was a child were, you know, 48% of the audience. And, you know, you got a 23 and it was a catastrophe. So things have definitely changed.
Yeah. So you kind of grew up in that world. In what way would you say that it has impacted your career choices?
You know, I think the idea that storytelling was, you know, and he was very much more an executive, not necessarily involved in the creative elements. I mean, he was in a sense, but he never moved into production. And I don't remember him reading a tremendous amount of, you know, scripts. I don't think that the development process was necessarily the same at that point. I think you just relied on your showrunners and your producers and you bought concepts. But I do think, you know, there was always a love of literature in our home and the idea that new stories were constantly coming in, I think just sort of sent me on the path of, you know, studying literature, which is what I did at university. And then the transition from that to sort of more, you know, creative and the desire to continue telling stories just came very naturally.
Mm. And how did you get into the TV drama business?
I actually went, it sort of was a circuitous route. I had always loved literature, obviously, but at a certain point, sort of, I was in New York. I was actually working with a French fashion photographer, a woman named Brigitte Lacombe, and had the benefit of living in a family apartment that was sold because my father was getting remarried and changing his life. And so I had to get a job that really paid, and called a friend of mine who got me a job as the assistant to an associate producer on a multi-camera comedy show. And I had done internships and things in the television business before, but I never really thought that
it would
be a career.
And how old are you at this point?
21.
Yeah.
So I went off to work in post-production on a multi-camera comedy, which was really interesting training. Mm. And then from there, went and worked with Michael J. Fox, and then from Michael J. Fox to HBO.
And what would you say? You worked in charge of development at Michael J. Fox's company for about 3 years,
yeah,
right? So what would you say was your greatest lesson from that? Because then we come into HBO, and these are kind of like your earlier
I think what was interesting about that was that regardless of the kind of success you had or the stories you were ready to tell, that there was a business behind the behind the storytelling. So what was interesting was that we had, I think, two movies greenlit that were movies that I had developed, but there was always a different agenda with his agency or, you know, his attorneys or with the studio that we were at, and which prevented those movies from being made. So it wasn't really enough to develop good material. It was, there was always a different agenda. And so for me personally, it was very painful because I had this great relationship with him and a great desire to help grow him as an actor and to grow the company, but it became apparent that it wasn't really going to happen because there were financial interests that were stronger than sort of the creative desires of the company. And that's when I decided to make the change. And I was actually very calculated in the way I wanted to go about it, because in working with him, having done multi-camera comedy and then moved into sort of single camera development and then feature development, I realized that I really appreciated working with feature talent, but I didn't really appreciate the traditional American network process creatively, although I did appreciate the speed of it. So I sort of targeted HBO, and I got really lucky because they were at a time in their development where they were making the move from a network that was much more focused on sports, documentaries, stand-up comedy, but they didn't have a drama division. And it was, I thought, quite bizarre that they...
And this was beginning of 90s?
Yeah, early 90s.
Yeah.
It was kind of odd that I had only worked in comedy and they asked me to start the drama division, but it worked.
And it was Chris Albrecht. Mm-hmm. What has he meant for you in your career?
Oh, Chris is a phenomenal person. I mean, he's definitely has a reputation as being a very sort of specific kind of individual, very much a one-man show. But he's really smart. He's a great manager. He really empowered, I think, all of us under him to take creative risks, and I think that that's a rare thing in a manager. And so he really gave me the sense of comfort and fearlessness to really try new things. And I think that that was part of what the HBO agenda was at the time, was to really do things that no one else would do, and to be fearless about it.
And what kind of instructions were you given? What were you supposed to do, change? I mean, it was a channel with boxing and stand-up comedy, like you said, and geared towards a male audience.
It was really much more a male audience. We also had HBO's demographic at the time was also very split. We had sort of a ethnic, lower economic class of people who used HBO as their primary form of entertainment because it was $10 a month, and then they wouldn't have to go see movies. They would watch their movies because HBO, of course, was a movie channel as well. And then we had the people who just thought, like, oh, $10 a month, I don't feel it, it doesn't matter. Mm. So we had a very split demographic. And the instructions basically were, because at the time we did have comedies on the air, there was a show called Dream On that was one of the first big comedies. And I remember Chris saying to me, just go out and create a drama so that we get reviews that say what HBO did for comedy, they've done for drama.
Okay, so that was like what you were supposed to, this small feat that you were supposed to do.
Yeah.
And then you the first series that was created was Oz.
Yes.
And it's a groundbreaking series in so many ways. And it really put HBO on the map. And I thought that, I guess most of the people have seen it, but I think we should look at the clip anyway.
Okay.
You want to introduce it? It's the second one of the ones we were looking at with the kind of backstory. Why?
Yes. Well, you know, as we were developing the show, I developed the show with Tom Fontana, who I'm sure most of you know because he's such a prolific showrunner. And one of the things that I wanted to do was to do something that was in a precinct that would be producible, but that was a precinct that nobody else could possibly do. And at the time, HBO was, of course, the premium television provider. So there were, you know, there were maybe three channels when my father was doing what he was doing, and now there were maybe five because it was HBO and Showtime. Mm. So, you know, prison seemed like the likely, well, the likely, it was a likely choice because obviously we weren't going to do something medical or legal because those areas had really been exploited beautifully on network television. But it took quite a while for us to figure out a way to make the show accessible. And in this clip, you're going to see sort of how we went about doing that.
Mm. Okay, so let's watch the clip and then I think we can just kind of, I don't know, how much in the way are we? Should we get off stage? It's like 2 minutes. Get off stage. No, we can stay. No, on, off, on, off. let's stay. You see them? So yeah, you can put the lights out then. And that ended up being, it's six seasons, right? And I was talking to actually my roommate, who's gay, and he was talking about Austin, how he was such a great fan. And it is groundbreaking. The main character starts a love story with another man. And I mean, this is just, for me, you're targeting a male audience, and this is 97. So was that a big issue, this kind of... that part of the story?
Well, I think we got to see what the evolution of those characters was. And Tom, you know, what was funny is it took us at least 2 years to develop it, and I had to keep sending him back because his training had been more in network television to push things further, to, you know, to really take risks and to do things that were darker and more different. The one thing that we did figure out together was that we needed someone like Tobias Beecher as a window in so that you could say, well, if I had had one glass too many of, you know, one glass of wine too many, that could be me. Because I know for myself as an audience member, you know, going to that place and staying there, I would need to have some way to really understand what was going on. But once Tom got into it and once we started getting feedback, he just went crazy. So he, you know, he killed all the characters at the end of the first season. He had people transform. You know, Tobias Beecher becomes like a crazy person. People are having relationships with each other, killing each other, you know, transforming sort of before your very eyes. But it was really in success that it freed him up to really go as far as he wanted to go. And it almost became a sort of fantasy in a weird way.
And you worked with him in Borgia, for example, later on as well. So you were one of the first female executives at HBO, and it's a very male environment. Did this somehow affect your job and career?
You know what, it was a very interesting place, and I think it has something to do with just the time at which I was there. I was the first executive really to have a child to go through sort of pregnancy, and in the United States it was before, you know, it was at a time when, you know, you had your child, you checked into the hospital. I know when our daughter was induced, and was checked into the hospital at 11:59 p.m. and I was supposed to be out within 24 hours. I mean, the U.S. medical system is very, very different, and as a result, there was a tremendous pressure to sort of go back, and also a fear that, you know, what if I don't come back? So it was a very, you know, different time. So
would you say it's changed now?
I think it has. I mean, I worked until 6 o'clock the night that I, you know, delivered our daughter, and I probably would do the same thing just because that's sort of who I am. But I do think that taking time off is probably easier in the United States now than it was. I mean, we were in the middle of doing...
And I mean, now you're in a country where people are away for like 8 months.
Yeah. So no, I mean, I was in my clothes in a meeting that, you know, I think I had Claire on a... I figured out how to like induce her on Friday night, have her on Saturday, take the weekend off, and I was in a meeting for Oz on Wednesday. So, you know, it was a very different time, and I don't know that, you know, given a choice, I would do it again, but I was very, you know, I realized that I was in a place that was doing, you know, interesting work, and I wanted to continue to do that work, so.
So if you could go back to your, like, 30-year-old self and give advice, what What would that be now when you're?
Oh, I think
you have more experience.
I think it would be just to have more confidence, you know, in myself as a person, and you know, to think about my personal agenda in a way a little bit more than thinking about the agenda of a company. Not that you don't want to go and do the best job you can for that company, but to also think about what your life might be like after that job, and to keep your eye on your future goals as opposed to, you know, what's immediately in front of you. And to be a little bit more strategic, maybe.
Have like a 5-year plan or something like that. Yeah. So we're going to go on to talk about your projects after HBO, but I want to ask you one final question about HBO, and it's quite a hard and big one, but what would you say the cultural impact of HBO has been on the drama culture and business? It's a huge question.
I think, well, it's huge, but I think that it's really simple. I think that, you know, HBO, because they had the ambition to really do things that were different, and because they were asking people to really pay for their programming, forced drama into a more sophisticated direction, you know, and broke the molds of what, in the United States, television is obviously much more of a machine. It's very sort of journeyman, and there's a real system, and it's what enables producers and studios to turn out, you know, 26 episodes a year of a multiple series. You know, it's very machine-like, and I think that HBO broke that mold and attracted talent that wanted to tell more individual stories, serialized stories, stories about people who felt more real, who represented different parts of the population. And I think they laid the groundwork for a lot of the drama that we're seeing today. Not that HBO would have done exactly all those stories, but I think HBO really opened the door, and I think Showtime to a degree too. I think the idea of premium cable opened the door for people and talent to tell stories that were meaningful to them and that didn't have to endure for, you know, 100 episodes. Mm.
And now, of course, later today we'll get to hear from HBO Nordic that are going to start producing original programming here. So you also, this is a huge part, but I'm going to semi-skip it. So you started the miniseries department with From the Earth to the Moon. You worked with Tom Hanks and, again, Band of Brothers. And, of course, The Corner, which is a legendary show. And then you stopped working there in 2004.
Yeah.
Right. And one of the last things you did was put together Rome. And you had half of the money from Europe. And I guess that's kind of the instigator for the rest of your career. Can you tell us a little bit?
Yeah, you know, it was interesting because Band of Brothers was the first time I did something that I was actively involved in the putting together of the co-production. From the Earth to the Moon attracted a lot of money just because it was sort of the space race was very global in terms of its interest. But when we did Band of Brothers, there was active interest from the English, primarily, you know, BBC, and then I think Canal Plus, to participate in the show, although they were somewhat passive participants. And when we developed Rome was developed actually as a mini series in three arcs. It was sort of my way of getting back into drama, into continuing series. And when the script came in, Chris Albrecht read the scripts and the first three, and he loved them. But he said, you know, we can never afford to make this unless we have a foreign partner. And so it was the first time I sort of jumped on a plane with the writer who happened to be English. And we went to the BBC, and they read the scripts, and we walked out of our meeting with £800,000 an episode. And I'll never forget, it was August.
Good meeting.
It was August 10th. I called Chris Albrecht and said, now you have to put your money where your mouth is. And he said, you know, what? I said, I got £800,000 an episode for this show. Now we have to make it. And then Canal Plus fell into place shortly thereafter, and then Rai. And so, you know, with those three partners, and then other territories, we managed to make half that budget before we had shot one frame of film. So it was really kind of an exciting time, an exciting show.
I think most of the people here have seen Rome. Of course, it's perfect mix of sex and violence and a lot of extras. No, but it's combined with the drama and the humor. I love that show. And then later on you did it's more recent. You did Versailles, and we're also gonna see the trailer for your new project, Britannia, that is for Sky and Amazon. It's coming out for in the summer. What is this obsession with the kind of lavish historical drama?
I just think, personally, I just think in history there's such great stories in history, and I think that. It's not that I don't like contemporary stories, because I do very much. It's just that, you know, you start to become known for one thing, and then those stories start to come to you. There are still a few more that I have that I'm working on, although I'm trying to diversify a bit more and do things that are a little bit more contemporary. But I do think that, you know, for instance, with Rome, what was so fascinating to me was the idea that we're all human beings. Rome is really the seat of Western civilization in many ways, and yet the moral universe was completely different. And I think that to put yourself in a different time and place, in the same way that, you know, you do with the characters of Oz, and to think, well, there but for the grace of God go I, who would I be if I had been born a woman 2,000 years ago or a Roman soldier 2,000 years ago? How would I feel about things? How would I make my decisions? You know, and it's, for me, I love learning, so the idea that, you know, the things that I learned that probably nobody even knows about Rome, but that were like sort of our inside secrets, were in ancient Rome there were no words for yes or no. So you can go through the entire series and nobody says yes or no.
Wow.
The ideas of paterfamilias, where, you know, you give birth to a child and you place the child in the doorway, and if the father of the child doesn't acknowledge it, it's thrown into the garbage, because a child wasn't considered human until it could live with its hands open and stand on its own. It just wasn't considered fully baked. So there are all sorts of interesting things that become the underpinning for drama, I think, in a historical context, that just kind of fascinate me. So I think that's sort of how it started.
And Versailles, it was rolled out in the Nordics in the fall on C-More. I think the only country, maybe it was on Ruv in Iceland, I think. But a lot of people haven't seen it if they don't have that SVOD service. So we have a clip from that, and that one I think we should really watch. So do you want to? So the basics is that it's about the Sun King Louis the 14th.
Yes.
And what's the clip we're gonna?
Let me give a little bit of background of how we started. The series starts at a time when Louis the 14th, as a younger man, there was an attempt to overthrow him. So in order to consolidate his power at one point, he decides he wants to move the court to Versailles, which is not a beautiful palace at the time, but his father's former hunting lodge and kind of a dump. So he moves people in order to control them, and he will build the palace into the image of what he wants it to be. The clip you're about to see is a clip that is about the birth of one of his children. And it's based, the last frame is somehow based in truth. So I will tell you about it after we watch
Perfect.
The clip.
So let's watch the Versailles clip.
So in researching the births and the children of Louis the 14th, the writers found reference to a black child, a little girl, who was born in the royal household, to whom the queen and king paid a visit once a year. She was at birth given to a convent, and she was raised in the convent, and every year she was paid a visit by the king and the queen, and she had a royal stipend for the duration of her life. So, you know, similarly to what we did in Rome, where we took the historical framework of the facts that we knew, everything in between, we gave ourselves the liberty to invent.
Yeah.
And so Simon Mirren and David Wollstonecraft decided they thought it would be very interesting if the queen actually gave birth to this child, and that then there's an insinuation that, because also dwarves were kept as almost pets at the time, and there was a black dwarf that the queen kept as her friend and her pet, and so there's speculation that perhaps that dwarf was the father of this child or some visiting dignitary. And you never, I mean, we have absolutely no idea, but they took the kernel of this child being raised in a convent and created a story around it.
And a very, very good poignant scene. So your latest production is Britannia that I mentioned, and we're going to see a trailer of it, I think, to finish everything off. But tell us about that show.
Britannia is about the last Roman conquest of Britain, or the last attempted Roman conquest of Britain. And it's an interesting piece in that it's somewhat fantasy, somewhat historical, and it's a marriage of sort of the Roman values, the Druidic and the Celtic. So it's really a melange of all those things. It's quite muscular and interesting. We have actually a fantastic actor at its center that I think a lot of you will recognize, Nikolai Likas, who I just adore. So we have a little Nordic element. But have a look.
Yeah, let's look at it. And I think we started a little bit later. I will not take anything from your time, so let's watch the trailer and then talk a little bit at the end. So let's stay. Okay, you can roll the Britannia now. I think it looks amazing. It's definitely the kind of series I want to see. So it said Sky and Amazon. Could you tell us a little bit about the funding and also how it's going to be screened?
Well, Sky initially commissioned it, and Amazon came in quite early with a pretty substantial contribution, which obviously helps. But Sky,
what kind of budget does this have? Are you allowed to say? Might be a little bit higher than like the basic normal Nordic drama.
My understanding is it's the highest commission that Sky has ever done on their own.
Okay.
So it's pretty substantial.
Mm. It looks like you really used it on screen.
Yeah, I mean, honestly, we worked with a producer who I absolutely love, who I would work with on everything, a guy named Rick McCallum. I'm sure some of you know him. He started Lucasfilm with George Lucas, and he did Young Indy and the first three Star Wars movies. And he's based in Prague, which is where we shot the majority of this. We also shot in Wales, which is where you see sort of the coastlines.
But yeah.
Rick is just an incredible, incredible producer, and the team that we have in the Czech Republic is remarkable in their, you know, work ethic and their ability to double bank and really make the most of a budget. Because, as you could see, we shot on a lot of locations, which can be very expensive and costly. And when you don't have cover sets and things like that, it's a bit tricky. So. I was very happy that Rick was able to participate, because it made all the difference, I think, in our ability to stay on budget and sort of on time.
So do you have, is there anything you can talk about regarding future projects? Or
it's going to be really interesting to see. There's a project that I've developed with the historical consultant of Rome, a guy named Jonathan Stamp, who it's his first script, and he wrote something on spec for me about Ellis Island. Which he was very hesitant to go out with, because as a first-time writer, he was really afraid that if he didn't have this big package behind him, it wouldn't happen. And, I'm really a firm believer in just writing and good stories, and that the package can come to it afterwards. Sometimes it works out that there's a package, and that's great, and other times I think you just have to be confident in the work. And we actually just went out with it to American broadcasters over the weekend, so I'll be very curious to see, given the political climate in the United
States. And it's taking place in the beginning of the 20th century?
It takes place in, the series would take place from 1902 to 1914, so a time when America welcomed 7 million immigrants through Ellis Island, and today nearly 50% of Americans owe their American nationality to the gateway that is Ellis. So.
Yeah.
You know, we were all in many ways refugees, and it's going to be very interesting to see how the networks respond to that material this weekend. So that's something that another historical piece. But
and good luck with that. We were talking about it over dinner, and it sounds like it's a really interesting concept and idea, and also more than 100 years later, very relevant.
Yeah, and
today.
You know what? I'm passionate about it, and what's so interesting about it for me personally is that. To find someone in history, a guy named William Williams, through whose eyes we're telling the story, who was an upper crust, sort of white establishment attorney, who didn't particularly like immigrants, thought they were dirty, thought, you know, he had all of those preconceptions himself personally, but who was dedicated to the law and dedicated to justice and overcame his own personal aversion to certain things in order to do what was right. And so I'm really hopeful that it gets a good response, and I'm hopeful that we get to expose it globally at some point as well, because I think that obviously it's an issue that affects all of us, and it feels we've lost a little bit of our humanity in the United States, and I'd like to help use what we do to open people's eyes again to who we are or who we should be.
I think those are perfect ending words to our discussion. Thank you so much for
coming. Thanks.